have to talk about Lena Dunham and nepotism, because I think this is annoying and pisses me off. So it seems like it appears as if Black Lives Matter has morphed into, yeah, the protest against police brutality following the killing of George Floyd, which led to a resurgence or revival of Black Lives Matter, which then has led to some weird form where now we have black people on social media essentially trying to push for, I don't know, occupational reparations in that regard. Does that make sense? Employment reparations, right? They're essentially going after industries and areas where they feel as if they've been overlooked, and trying to readjust the balance by getting white people fired or by raising questions about white people's worth in that field so that they can replace them, right? This is what essentially is morphed into, which is really, really dangerous. But we should have seen the writing on the wall as soon as people were talking about equality of outcome, right? Not equality of opportunity, which is what most people should be pushing for. And in my opinion, I think it's a real missed opportunity, because I think the killing of George Floyd was, you know, it's terrible, right? Really, really terrible. Super gruesome. I think about that video so many times randomly, right? I'll be in the kitchen making something to eat and just popping my head, just picturing him lying on the floor and essentially having his life squeezed out from him, right? It's just utterly horrifying to think about. But it's one of the most unique situations because, you know, we've seen so many videos of police brutality all over the world, especially in America. And no other video managed to galvanize the entire world for once, right? We never had it happen. We always had the thing of like a police brutality video happens and then you get people on the right trying to explain away why what we're seeing isn't what we're seeing. At the moment, the only person we've got really out there who's really against George Floyd and kind of butting against the narrative is Candace Owens, right? She essentially is basically saying that we shouldn't be making him out to be a martyr. He might have died via the hands of a cop, but he got himself in trouble in the first place. He was a bad guy. He was a drug addict. You know, that's what it kind of, she's the only person I've seen so far that's been going ham and saying that, you know, what we're seeing isn't real. But most people, regardless of how far right they are, of how conservative they may be in their views, they can agree that, okay, that was unjust. So it was a really rare opportunity to really galvanize everybody in an effort to kind of push against how society is sort of structured at the moment, right? Between the haves and the haves not, especially in terms of equality of opportunity, not outcome, opportunity. Because I think most people, that's what they suffer from. They suffer from the opportunity of not being given a chance to prove their worth. And I think I always attribute this to football, because growing up, when we used to try and play, there's a lot of people in my ends who are really good at football, right? Who probably could have gone on to become professionals. But, you know, through luck of the draw, injuries, just getting caught up in the lifestyle, you know, on the streets and whatever it may be, they kind of fell by the wayside. But a common mantra we had back in the day when we used to play football in a cage was we just wanted the opportunity. We all kind of played our guts out so that, you know, in the hopes in the back of our head that if Arsene Wenger's taxi happened to like break down next to the cage while we were playing, he'd see how talented we are and give us a chance to play, right? That's what we wanted. You just wanted the opportunity. But you understood that you were as good as everybody else you saw on TV, but they had the chance to play in front of somebody that was a decision maker, a shot caller, a gatekeeper, who then were able to like, hey, they kind of gave you the blessing and you were kind of ushered in. Because we also understood as well, like Ryan Tannehill is a good example, I keep mentioning him, but once you become a professional footballer, it's very difficult for you to then suddenly not be one later on down the line. Even if you fall really, really down the kind of football pyramid, you're still going to be able to support yourself and your family by playing football. That's the beauty of going into an industry. And most of the things, I think you even see it with the Kim Kardashian deal recently, with this Kim Kardashian signed a deal where she's selling a part of her company to Coty, right? We see that because that's a good example of, like, you know, the rich getting richer. Because once you're able to have some level of fame, some level of exposure, some level of success in your business, it just attracts more business to you because people see the value that you can bring to their brand and they want to be associated with it. It's just what it is. So I think the killing of George Floyd was a real opportunity to galvanize people to push for equality of opportunity, to make, I don't know, to enact policies, to change hiring processes, something that was going to be sufficient enough to enable people to actually be put into a position where they can make decisions that would benefit their particular racial group, their particular interest group, whatever it may be, however kind of twisted and slanted it may be. That was what was really important. This sniping at people like Lena Dunham and saying, oh, she shouldn't have the position because her show's shit and she's mediocre and white, isn't constructive. It really isn't, because who cares? And there's so many nuances that are attributed to somebody's successes. To just reduce it down to race is really reductive and extremely naive. And this screenshot kind of proves it as much. This is from Pop Crave. It's a really good Twitter profile I recommend you check out. Loads of populated news, but just kind of, you know, general mainstream stuff, but some good points that you can kind of, it gives you a good overview of what's actually going on in a sort of like lamestream general media sort of avenue. So this was kind of spurned by this tweet that went viral on the left of the screen here by a guy called Ahmed Best, right, who took a screenshot of a Hollywood Reporter article from 2017, right, which goes to show the amount of vitriol some of these people in this movement, or in general at this current time, have and anger they have towards the system and the industry. It's palpable and it's real, but I think it's misdirected. It shouldn't be directed towards the individuals. It's directed towards the institutions that allow for a Lindum to come through and just in your pitch meeting to have a half done script and get, you know, and become as successful as she is. That's the issue, not so much herself, because she might be mercurial, she might be super talented, she could probably be, she might be in a 1st percentile that's able to get away with doing a one pager of a script and still have a show. That's something you have to kind of, you know, suck up and realize that might be the case. But so anyway, the tweet that went viral was this Ahmed guy basically quote tweeted a Hollywood Reporter tweet that says the following: Lynn Dunham was 23 years old when she sold Girls to HBO with a page and a half long pitch without character nor plot. So back in 2017, this would have been an inspirational message in some regard, right? People would have seen that and said, oh my God, wow, that's so cool. As long as you get yourself in the opportunity, as long as you get yourself through that door, as long as you're in that room, anything can happen, which is true, right? Which is why people, you know, which is why the whole term of elevator pitches, you know, is popularized or is glamorized. The idea is that you might bump into Jeff Bezos in an elevator and you've got 5 minutes or less than to convince him that your idea is worth investing in, and suddenly you know, through luck or through whatever it may be, your life is completely changed via the, you know, 30 second pitch you're able to deliver to Jeff Bezos in a lift. That's the thing. But we obviously have all collectively understood that it's more, what's more important isn't that you're white or isn't that you're black. The most important thing is that you're able to get inside that lift to be with Jeff Bezos in the first place, which allows, you know, which is takes a lot. So that's what the problem is structurally. But then Ahmed Best quotes tweets it and says, oh, I have a master's degree in film and teach film at top tier university and an over 25 year professional career. And I walk into pitches with a fully realized Bible pilot and 7 seasons arc. And oftentimes I'm told, no, it's not enough. But Lena Dunham, cool. So essentially he's attributing the reason why he hasn't been successful to Lena Dunham's success basically down to race, which is really disingenuous, because he knows that's not true. Because, you know, there might be this thing that you have to kind of fess up, especially when it comes to the arts. I don't know. I really get sensitive about it, because I think people get, when it comes to the creative industries, everyone that works in that space, you are aware in some way, shape or form, you have to be aware that the job you're doing is pretty meaningless, right? For the most part, right? Anyone could replace you. There's a kid probably out there who's drawing better than, who's kind of illustrating at the moment much better than you are, but he doesn't have any following. He's got 10 Instagram followers. No one cares about what he's doing, but he's incredibly talented. There's a girl out there writing amazing scripts. No one listens to what she's doing. There's a guy out there who's really funny in a podcast. No one listens to what he's saying. There are people out there who are doing just as good as you are, but you have the privilege and you have the opportunity to kind of have the platform that you have, the exposure, blah, 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 to amplify your voice, which is great. But you're not under the illusion that you're somehow better than everybody else. That's why you're in that position. It's kind of like a hard thing to quantify, right? It's a little bit of talent. It's a little bit of hard work, perseverance, connection, network, timing. But there's a lot that goes into making you successful in the creative field. It's not just a matter of, oh, I'm white. Oh, I've got connections. Oh, my parents are rich. If that was the case, then we would have a lot more mediocre TV shows on at the moment than are really on TV. Let's be real about this. And it also raises an ugly question, or an unfortunate question that people don't really want to fess up to. You might have to look yourself in the mirror and think, maybe I'm just not good enough. Maybe the free market decided that maybe my Bible pilot, which this guy said he wrote 7 seasons of a show that a network didn't want to pick up. Maybe me writing 7 seasons isn't as good as Lynn Dunham writing 1. That could be an actual thing. Or it might be the case that back when girls, again, and I'm not even a big fan of Lena Dunham herself, right? I think she's an absolute donkey, right? In general, right? I think she's an absolute oaf. I've never been a fan of Girls. I thought it was shit when it first came out. I maybe artistically or creatively appreciated the first 2 seasons, but I thought the premise behind these characters being people that girls kind of looked up to or had friends or were in any way believable was really disgusting and really, you know, far-fetched and missed the mark. But again, I'm a dude. What the hell do I know? And considering its success, it obviously resonated with a large majority of people. Now, at that moment, at that time, that aesthetic of girls and what it was about and the fact that Lena Dunham was, I don't know what, she did this web series that I remember being really big at the time, right? She was spoken about in really, in a lot of ways, the same way Childish Gambino was, right? Like a few years back when everyone was sort of like heralding him as a savant. That's what she was kind of riding off the back of. And it was evident that she was actually very talented. She knew what she was doing. When it came to writing for TV shows, writing these movies, writing scripts, crafting characters, she has obviously a knack, an ability, a flair for somehow synthesizing, you know, that sort of like yuppie, hipstery, whatever thing that was going on in those kind of, in that early 2000s era when Girls was on. It was a very much a reflection of the times, very much a reflection of her peer group, of that scene. No one can deny that. To suggest that somehow her success was only because of race is dumb, because it's like The Sopranos. Sopranos, you know, was a success when it came out because it might have been during a time when, you know, mob movies were really in. And this guy comes along with this, you know, amazing script, you know, which led to The Sopranos, and then it gets greenlit and suddenly it becomes a success. But it's not because, you know, the guy happened to be, I don't know, connected to this TV executive, this person, that it gets success. It might just be purely based on talent and timing. And I think that is real conversation. And I think sometimes, you know, I don't know, I just feel as if like this reparations that's going on at the moment with careers and with opportunity and with outcomes is really missing the mark, because there is a real need to readjust the balance as to why maybe an Ahmed Best isn't, you know, in the rooms when it comes to the making decisions on what gets greenlit, so that he can maybe, you know, lend an ear, push for a certain type of programming to be, you know, put onto those networks. But it also has to be accepted that, you know, let's say you do all the cultural, racial adjustments that need to be done, right? You get, you know, 50-50 parity in terms of, you know, black and white shows on TV. You reduce it to just that, right? And then, you know, people vote with their eyes and then with their remote controls and say, no, we don't want the black stuff. And the black stuff gets really low ratings and you just watch all the white stuff. What happens then? Do you then suggest that somehow people need to be retrained at what they like and don't like? Then we get into some really murky waters. So I just think what we should be aiming for is a quality of opportunity. Give everybody a chance. Everybody should be able to have a chance to pitch a show if you have the talent, you have the ability, you have the wherewithal, you have the determination, the drive to follow through on a script, to write something. You know, I've got a blog and I don't even update that. I know how hard to write is, right? Writing is difficult. It's not a fun job. And again, it's not something that everyone will want to do. But if you want to get into that arduous task of writing and putting together a script, putting together a show, a pilot, you should have the chance to pitch it to somebody that can decide whether or not this thing is greenlit to go on TV. That's the most you should be given. Outcome and, you know, to be kind of given this kind of, to be given a show basically based on your color of your skin, only for then for your show to get completely dumped after the first 8 episodes because no one's watching it, is going to do a lot more damage than good for you and for the cause going forward. So yeah, I just don't know how beneficial this is. And another tweet again that's kind of, you know, ragging on Lena Dunham, saying, and it turned out great, it says here, risks are inherent to Hollywood ecosystem. It's how networks and executives stand out and set themselves apart. It says the problem is black creatives don't get these kinds of opportunities to prove themselves. Somehow the standards of the unproven are skewed, which is true. That's what I agree with the Kendall lady on the side here, Kendall Jamal. We need to give everybody opportunity, which kind of goes back to the old DJ thing I was talking about the other day, right? About, you know, this woke techno Twitter sort of like on a rampage to essentially readdress the balances on lineups. I don't know, man. I don't know if that's the right way to go about it. Maybe we just need to get to a point. Maybe it's not even a conversation to be had in front of the camera. It's something to be done behind the scenes. Like, for instance, if, let's say Bergkind is the leader, right? Let's say Bergkind is sort of like the industry leader. Everyone kind of follows their lead. They closed their club, I think the earliest in Berlin, right? They were the first to close when coronavirus broke out. They kind of took the lead in that regard. Essentially took down a website, which kind of, you know, has a list of all the victims of police brutality and charities you can kind of donate to. So they were really forward with kind of addressing what was going on socially. Now, let's say behind the scenes, Bergkind don't make any announcements in front of camera, but behind the scenes, they commit to having their lineup be 20% represented by minorities or POCs, whatever you say, and then maybe 50% women. That readdresses the balance immediately, right? But then he also has a problem of like, what pool are you pulling from? Are you just pulling shit people to represent people of minorities and just to kind of tick the quota box? Or are you going for the best of the best? And if it's the best of the best, that's great, because then it inspires people from within that, you know, racial demographic to be like, okay, cool. Someone looks like me is doing that thing and they're really good. I'm going to go do it too. Whereas if you get someone that's mediocre, like what's happening with Virgil, right? You have like a sort of like a, you know, whatever, a mediocre designer who works really hard and has really good connections, who's able to kind of craft this amazing career for himself, but everything that he does, it just doesn't really hit the mark. It can inspire some people to be like, oh wow, if he can do it, I can. But it also can build resentment in the group that you're trying to really inspire, right? Where they can be like, oh my god, it's a particular kind of black person and that gets that job, right? It just perpetuates this cyclical, you know, eating of ourselves, which is really harmful, which is why I think we shouldn't really focus on the economy equality of outcome. We should focus on equality of opportunity. Everyone should have the chance to prove themselves, to have the opportunity to get that job, to get that gig, to get that placement, to get that internship. And then I think it will be better for everybody going forward. But I'm not liking this revisionist history of like, oh, Lena Dunham was never good. She was never talented. No, she was. You might not like her show. Like, I didn't like her show. I wasn't necessarily a fan of it. But you can't deny that she wasn't able to expertly kind of synthesize what was going on during that time and somehow be able to kind of put that on camera. Come on, man. Let's not say that.